the Red Sox won it. And after they came back from 0-3 down against the Yankees, they literally were empowered. There was nothing that was going to stop them. They took it out on the field. It didn't matter. You never got the feeling that they were in danger, ever. Did you ever get the feeling they were in danger in any of these games at all, no matter what the score was?
Yes.
I didn't.
Yes,
you,
we're Red Sox fans. We had a little bit.
I didn't, Maria. Honestly, after being around these guys, they didn't feel like that at all. They were supremely confident. You saw Terry Francona give the green light on 3-0 tonight. I mean, they played like they wanted to win the championship, and that's why they won it.
And Butch, I think a telling part of this series, everyone wants to talk about Jeff Suppan and his, you know, his problems on the base paths. They seem to gloss over the fact that last night the Cardinals get up in the first inning, down by one run. They have the bases loaded with one out. Do they hit a double in the gap? Do they hit a triple, you know, over the right fielder's head? No, they pop out to left field. Manny throws them out at the plate. These are the things that people weren't focusing on. The fact that in game one they had the bases loaded in the eighth inning with the tie game. Keith Folk comes in. He gets Jim Edmonds. He gets Scott Rowland. The Cardinals just didn't play their game, bottom line.
I think the amazing thing to me is I think Terry Francona and Theo Epstein and Red Sox manager deserve a lot of credit here, because we saw the long hair and the idiot's phrase and all of that, but there were a lot of things that went on behind the scenes with this team that could have easily become distractions. Guys were treated differently. We're going to hear a lot about this in the next couple weeks. We're going to talk a lot about Pedro. In my opinion, he is gone. You heard Tony Maserati say he'll be back here. We'll see. Maybe the feelings of a world championship will change that. But I know for a fact that there are a lot of people in the Red Sox organization that are kind of tired of the preferential treatment that he demands by the way he acts. And again, I'm not trying to be negative. We're going to hear a lot about this. But at this night, I think Theo and Terry Francona in particular deserve a lot of credit for keeping those things in-house, so to speak, and not allowing that to affect the way the team played on the field. That's exactly what happened with these guys.
What do you think the fate lies for Derek Lowe, Butch?
You know, that's going to be a very interesting question, because we saw tonight, as a matter of fact, several people were remarking out in the press box that Derek Lowe would be the ace on the St. Louis Cardinals team. So you know the Cardinals, and probably a handful of other teams are thinking about that. Someone very close to Derek Lowe told me last week after Game 7 that the Cardinals actually called Scott Boros and talked to him about Derek Lowe, and that he has six teams interested in him. That's coming from someone close to Derek Lowe. So I don't think there's going to be a lack of suitors for Derek Lowe, and honestly, I don't think the Red Sox are going to match a best offer that Derek Lowe gets out there from some other team.
And Butch, let's talk about Pedro again, because over the past couple of years, he starts out in April, he has a couple of rough starts. Red Sox fans, including myself, are saying, he's finished, get rid of him. Then he gets hot for a while, and we all say, eh, you know what, let's keep him. End of the year, he starts playing not so great again, and we're like, get rid of him again. But seeing him tonight with the trophy in his hands in the clubhouse, I think most people at home, and there's the picture right there, with the big smile, I mean, this guy is constantly smiling. Except for when the media asks him a question that he doesn't like, perhaps. But seeing these type of pictures, Butch, I think a lot of people at home really have a spot in their heart right now for Pedro. And I think they would really hope that he'll be back, although I know you say that you don't think he'll be back.
Well, you heard him at the podium last night. You heard those telling comments. And one thing about Pedro, if I can share a quick personal story, I mean, covering him for 7 years, the one thing I always admired and respected about Pedro was when you asked him a question, he gave you an answer. And unlike a lot of Latino players or Spanish-speaking players, he never hid behind the language. He not only spoke English, he understood English. He understood your questions. We all know what happened on the radio with Curt Schilling a week ago. Well, I found out a couple days after that that Pedro was very miffed at me also, and I confronted him, and I went to him, and I told him face-to-face, and he shook my hand, and he says, I respect you for that, for coming to see me. And that's the type of guy that Pedro was. It's going to be interesting to me, David. I hope I'm wrong about what I'm saying. I'm just sharing with you my thoughts about what I've been told behind the scenes. I hope I'm wrong, because Pedro is such an emotional guy that maybe this changes his feelings. Maybe he accepts less money to stay here. I just don't think the Red Sox is going to offer him Curt Schilling money, $39 million for 3 years. And I don't think there's going to be a lot of teams that will offer him that money. And maybe the best offer he gets is from the Red Sox, and maybe he does stay here. Maybe the parade on Friday changes everything for Pedro. But my gut feeling is he's not coming back here.
Well, we certainly hope that he stays. And we want to thank you, Butch. You've been unbelievable on the road in St. Louis, on the road in New York, on the road in Anaheim. We know that you've had a long couple of weeks, but we also know that tonight you're having a lot of fun.
Well, I got to share two quick things. One is I got to thank everybody that you know. It's a team effort with us here at Fox 25, and none of this happens without all of us here. It's a maddening experience behind the scenes. And two, My 8-year-old daughter Lillian called right before the game tonight. I told several people in the press box, and she told me right before the game, Johnny Damon and David Ortiz are going to hit home runs. I hung up. Damon hit the home run. So I called her back, and she said, well, it's actually going to be Mark Bellhorn next. So she's playing both sides. But she did predict that, so I got to give her a shout-out. And I got to come home and see my family, who I haven't seen in like a month.
All right, you've done a fantastic job for us.
Thanks,
really
David.
appreciate it, Butch.
That.
All right, thank you.
You guys too. All right.
Thank you, Butch. And Lily, you might have a job right here at Fox. Thanks, guys. Well, we have some new information right now on what's going on around Fenway. Doug Meehan, what do you have?
Well, we're up here on Comm Ave, Maria. We're down by the BU area. And Boston police have informed us that they have not been using tear gas to disperse these crowds. But I can tell you there were some canisters involving some type of smoke. What it was, we don't know, but they did want to call and confirm that, as you can see, this is a situation earlier where they just dropped in smoke and the crowds dispersed. And they're, again, repeating to us that it's not a tear gas, but it maybe is just type of a smoke dispersal type of canister that they ignite to help intimidate the crowds. Just to, again, repeat, our area right now is down the Commonwealth Ave area. Right out, BU is basically right underneath us. And you can see how police are working both sides, some of the smaller roads behind that run parallel with Comm Ave. And this line of police officers haven't really moved within the last 15 minutes or so. Some stragglers remain, as you see. You do have one or two folks to decide to fire up a little fireworks. And for the most part, this is pretty much over. As you can see, most parts of Comm Ave are cleared out. You do have a few incidents. I don't know if this is one of the dorms down there and whether or not that's BU police down in that area. But as you can see, this is right down on campus, or that stretch of campus down here on Comm Ave. And if I pull out, and if you bear with me, and if I pull over to the right, there was a few incidences down here on Beacon. But as I zoom in, you'd be able to see that it has since cleared out. And police officers just spanning across the road here, both sides, and this intersection is pretty much cleared. And this is what they were hoping for by just moving those crowds out. So I would have to say that a majority of our problems out here are pretty much over, except for a few stragglers that may remain out here on parts of Comm Ave, just lingering to see how far they can further push the limits and the frustration of Boston police, which I would say again, kudos to them. They did have some issues, obviously, but they've been able to do this and take out the troublemakers and let people party. They do let them celebrate, but when they think that it's time that, to call it, they do, and they move. And this is where we stand right now as we approach, oh my goodness, where's the night gone? We're coming up to 2 a.m.
All right, thank you.